Hi, I'm Jesper Pedersen from KDAB. This is a moment you've all been waiting for. Now we'll finally stop. We'll unmount the Control C and Control V from our keyboard. We'll not do cut and paste and just have a block here, copy it there, so we have three times the same thing with minor adjustments. We will do as we do in C++. We'll create classes. In QML, it's elements, but we'll create our own elements. I've dedicated three videos for this. After that, in this module here, we'll talk about local variables. It's not anything new, really, compared to what you've seen so far, but it's worthwhile to just put our fingers on it and say, what should you be aware of if you create local variables? If you created a user interface already. Or let me just put it this way. In KDAB, we help a lot of customers with their user interfaces. Everything works, the animations look good and everything, but the QML application takes a lot of memory and it takes a lot of time to start up. And the problem that people have when they see these things is that they do not use the loader element. Just imagine that you were creating a widgets application with 100 different dialogues. Would you instantiate all those dialogues up front? Of course you wouldn't. And in QML, you shouldn't do that either. But without the loader element, that is exactly what you do. So the fifth video in this module here, the loader element, do not drop that one. Do not skip that one because that is super important. And finally, I will come through on a promise earlier on in this series where I promised you that I will talk about focus scope. Focus scope is something that you need when you have keyboard focus in different places. But first, let's talk about how do we create our own module. How do we create our own elements? That's really what we want. There's two different ways of using or creating components in QML. We can do it using the component element. We'll see that many times when we talk about, especially the list view element, but also when we talk about loaders. Or you can do the other way that you can do it, namely using a file with a name that matches exactly what your component should be called. Let's see the second one right away. Here's a line edit that we've created up here. Remember, our text input is not decorated at all. So if you have a text input somewhere in the user interface, the user will not be able to see there's anything. You would like to have, just as we have here, a small green rectangle around your text input. And that's what we do in this example here. We create a file that we call lineedit.qml. Please read ahead on the slide. The last line on this slide is super important. It says that the file must start with a capital letter. Personally, at least, I created a lot of elements up front in my career, and I was, took me a while to realize, they only load if it's a capital letter. You've seen rectangle, it's a capital R in rectangle. You've seen text input, capital T, and so on. And it's not just a good convention, it's required when you create your own elements this way. So I take this stuff here, I'll put it into lineedit.qml, and if we look at what's happening here, I got a rectangle, it has the green border, that's the green pixels that you see here. It has a radius of 4. If you look really close here, you'll notice that the rectangle isn't sharp on the edges, that's the radius 4 here. Inside it, we got a text input. That's the thing that we type text into. It anchors fill the parent. I don't need to tell you how important that is anymore, I hope. And it has some text, and when it's focus, it's black. Otherwise, it's gray. That's our line edit. We store that in lineedit.qml, and now we can use our line edit just as we use any other element in QML. That's it. Don't need to talk about anything else. What? Wait. Oh, you want to be able to actually read the text out of the line edit. Oh yeah, I can see why you would want to do that. Okay, for that, we need properties. So let's see the example here. So this is a pretty simple example that is exactly what we have before. That's our line edit. Now, the next slide here tells you to be able to access the values of that line edit we created or the element in general, you need to create properties. We could already, if we wanted to, if we just go back here, we could, in our line edit element here, we could from the outside access the color, the radius, and the clip. But you can only access properties one level in, so it's not possible for us to access the text of that text input, and that's what we really want. For that, we need to create our own properties. We've seen that a few times in the previous video, that we can create our own properties, and we simply do that with a syntax that looks like this. Property, that's the keyword to tell us that we're creating a property. The name or the type of the property, the name of the property, and then optionally a default value for that property. And these properties are no special compared to all the other properties in QML. The right side of that colon is a property binding. So it doesn't need to be just a number as we see in this example here. Actually, on the last one, we actually do have a property binding with multiply by height. And when you have a property binding, what you often want to do is to avoid that we override that property binding. We had an example a few videos ago. Remember the one with three boxes where I could move in and out of one of them and I could click on the other one. And when I clicked, I overwrote that property binding that we had with the move in and out. Had I just marked this property as being read-only, that would have been impossible. So our slightly more advanced example is looking like this. Again, I got my rectangle, that's the outer one, let's just start it here. So I got my light blue rectangle around everything here. I have my line edit element, that's the one we have with the green arrow. I got text at the bottom, summary colon enter text. And I got an image, and that image is this one we have over here. And the idea is that whenever I press this cross, I will delete the content of my line edit. I could have made that inside of the line edit component, but I'm trying to show you some problem that we can have with this. Let's look at what the line edit element itself looks like. Just put your cursors on it, press F2, and it will jump us right to the line edit. And the only line that is different from what we had before is that we now have property, string, text, colon, text input dot text. Remember, you cannot dot your way into an element. You can only access the properties at the topmost level. So therefore, I simply have this text, new text property here that is the text of this element down here. And if I run it, you can see whatever I type, ABC, the text property that this is a binding for, let's just see the code here again, my text element, move it away. My text element here says text colon summary colon and then line edit.txt. So I read the line edit property here. And also my image there has a mouse area. The mouse area says unclicked line edit.txt equal to nothing. I will click it here and you can see that the text. Well, the text at least vanished down here. It didn't vanish up here, and now this doesn't work anymore. Why is that? Well, remember those three boxes? When I clicked on I think it was black. When I clicked on that box, it overwrite my property binding that we had in there. And that's exactly what we have here. Whenever I say whenever I do the click here, unclicked line edit.txt, line edit is this one up here. So let's see what that does. Whenever I press the button, line edit.txt equal to the empty string, it basically goes like this. So now there's no property binding down to the element anymore. So I guess we just need to go the other way around. So enter text dot dot dot. And then down here, I'll have a property binding going upward. So it will say parent.text. Now let's run this. And you can see now when I click it, it works. Almost. Now it doesn't work the other way around. And why is that? Well, whenever I I type text in here, then it basically the implementation of text input basically does this now, or whatever text I typed in there. For that, I actually need to have a enter text. There we are. I need to have another way of doing properties, namely with an alias. So property alias text should be my text input dot text. And now, fingers crossed. Yes, this worked, and yes, that worked. Yes, Burr. Can you tell me, when would you ever want to not have an alias then? Well, whenever you have something where you are inventing a new property. So in this example here, it could be that I wanted to be able to specify a diameter for the rounding of my edges rather than a radius. So I could write property int diameter, and let's make that 2, and then, well, I guess if we need to be compatible with the other one, it should be 8, then diameter divided by 2. Yes, Burr, doesn't that mean now that users could both access the new diameter and the old radios, and it would be confusing? Can you get rid of that old radios? Well, see, when you have an element, you can dot your way in on any of the properties of that topmost element. So in this situation, I cannot get rid of it, unless, of course, that I create an item outside. So I can create an item outside of the whole thing, and down there, and we indent it. And then that item, of course, doesn't have any properties up front, so my alias property would move up there. I better have my rectangle fill its parent so that it has a size there and so on. That was it for this video. What we are missing in the discussion of our new element is, how do we access signals and slots? Well, how do we create signals on our elements? And how can we create methods on those elements? And I deliberately took them into another video because, remember, I've said it many times by now, when you're programming QML, you should program declaratively, not program imperatively. Signals and methods are imperative programming. Sometimes it's useful to do those, but if you want to skip any video in this whole thing, maybe you should skip the next one, because that will teach you bad things. Well, it will give you the building blocks for doing bad things. That's it for this time. Thank you very much for listening in. And if you haven't done so already, hey, how about subscribing to our YouTube channel, and you will be notified as the first person in this world whenever we put out new material.